Welcome. On demand of many of the students, we'll be starting with a new section that is the expected questions for the UPSC examination, especially dealing with environment and biodiversity. So in this session, we'll start with the first set of expected questions for UPSC, mainly focusing on the prelims this time. So you have the first thing that we will cover is the cloud seeding project. Now in 2017, for good monsoon, there has been a kind of experiment done by Maharashtra government for a cloud seeding project. The project aims to sprinkle silver iodide onto the clouds and then track it with a ground radar system and see how the impact of rainfall or how the monsoonal variations could be made. Now this project is a kind of first controlled experiment which would try to quantify the differences in the rainfall pattern in India. However, there have been previous experiments done in various countries. Some of the path-breaking experiments were one of that done in China just before the Olympics 2008, and the aim was to clear the air pollution. The next was in United States. It aimed to bring precipitation to the drought-prone areas, especially done in the areas of Wyoming. Then you have in Australia the SISRO activities in Tasmania. It was again the seeding over of the hydroelectric commission catchment area on the central plateau, and the aim was to bring more rain into that area. And finally, another project was done by Russian military over Belarus when there was the Chernobyl disaster, and the idea was to remove the radioactive particles from the atmosphere and the clouds. So these were some of the path-breaking experiments done worldwide. If we look onto the project, the idea is to increase the amount of seeding. So once you have the seeding with AGI, that's the silver iodide, you would have a kind of bigger cloud and more rainfall. So this is how you understand. You have the aeroplane with which you sprinkle the silver iodide onto the clouds, and the seeding takes place, and then finally you have the rainfall. The next important topic is the Barren Island. That is one of the active volcanoes. In 1991, there was intermittent activity that was seen in the Barren Island, and it came after 150 years. So it was dormant for nearly 150 years, and in 1991 it was declared active. And finally, you have the seafloor samples that were studied. Now the recent January study says that in the daytime there was ash clouds that were seen, and during the time of sunset there was red lava coming out of the crater. So the scientists have considered this to be the black pyroclastic material that comes from the region, and this Barren Island is located nearly 140 kilometers northeast of Port Blair in Andaman and Nicobar Island. So you have Barren Island as another important topic for this time. The next is the newly formed fracture in the Indian Ocean. Now this fracture is seen in the Wharton Basin, so it's the Indian subcontinent, and you have the island groups of Indonesia here, and this region is the region of Wharton Basin, where you have a recent discovery of the fracture in Indian Ocean, and it is expected that this fracture would trigger the amount of or the number of earthquakes coming onto the region. So this was discovered by the scientists from Singapore and Indonesian universities. Now the basic analysis was done by the seafloor spreading and the seafloor depth analysis. This system is nearly 1,000 kilometer away from the Indian mainland or the Indian subcontinent, and this was again in news after the 2012 earthquakes. So you have the Wharton Basin, and this is very close to the 90 East Ridge. That is the 90 ridge that divides the east and the west meridians. Now we'll come on to some of the major topics related to biodiversity. The first is the Agastamalya Sanctuary. Now this Agastamalya is part of the Western Ghats, located in the state of Kerala. It mainly includes the tropical forest. So Shendurini, Pepara, Niara and Kalakad Muthumalai are the major tiger reserves which have been incorporated into the Agastamalya Sanctuary, and it has been declared as one of the 20 UNESCO Biosphere World Reserves. Again, UNESCO has declared one of the biosphere reserves in Myanmar, and that's the first biosphere reserve that has been declared in Myanmar. It lies in Inil Lake in Shan State of Myanmar. Now, since 1971, there have been Man and Biosphere program that have been released. The aim is to improve the interaction between people and environment, to safeguard the ecosystem and provide innovative approaches for economic development. So this is the map of the major biosphere reserves of India. As you can see, you have the Agastamalya Sanctuary located in Western Ghats in Kerala. And here are some of the other few important biosphere reserves that are mentioned on this map. So you have Seychelles Salem and Nilgiris as another important biospheres in the South India. Now, the next important reserve is the Paakhe Tiger Reserve. This Paakhe Tiger Reserve is located in Arunachal Pradesh in the East Kamang district. So this is the map of Arunachal Pradesh and this is the East Kamang district. So in the East Kamang district, you have the Paakhe Tiger Reserve and this has won the India Biodiversity Award for 2016. The idea is to protect one of the threatened species, that is the Hornbill Nest Adaptation Program. So this program is a kind of collaboration between the local dwellers, the state government and the Nature Conservation Foundation. Also, urban people are putting in money to protect the four species of hornbill in that area. Now, this award is given under four categories. First is the threatened species conservation. The next is the biological resource sustainable use. The benefits of the successful models that have been released, and finally the biodiversity management committee. So under these four categories you have this biodiversity award given, and Paakhe Tiger Reserve in Arunachal Pradesh East Kamang is one of those. So this is again important for prelims this time. The next is the decrease in the vulture population. Now vulture is one of the is important because it acts as a scavenger which eats on the dead and decayed material. Now if there are no vultures, what would happen? There would be more of pest infestation on the dead and decayed matter. As a result, there would be increase in number of feral dogs. If those feral dogs bite human beings, they can lead to rabies. It can lead to rabies. Now, the vulture population is declining because of the exposure to diclofenac, which acts as a kind of biomagnifier with each food tropic level, as we know and we have discussed in the food pyramids. So with each level there is a kind of bioaccumulation and you have the concentration of diclofenac that increases. A substitute for diclofenac is the meloxicam, which is safe for vultures and now has been introduced. Now due to this diclofenac, you have a kind of severe decline in the population in the Wayanad Sanctuary in Kerala. Now this constitutes part of Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve and the Elephant Reservoir number 7. This elephant reservoir has the largest population of Asiatic elephants in India. In Asia. Now, Haryana government has started another project which is known as GIPS Vulture Reintroduction Program, and that works under the Jatayu Conservation Program with the headquarters at Pinjore. And the aim is to protect the amount of vultures or the number of vultures in the country. Now, there has been another MOU that has been signed by India. India is the 56th nation to sign this MOU, and that is for raptor conservation. Raptors are the birds of prey commonly seen in Africa and Eurasia. So this agreement talks about the 76 species of the birds of prey, of which 46 species lie in India. The major species includes the falcons, eagles, vultures, owls and hawks and kites. So this is in line with the Wildlife Conservation Act 1972, and the other neighbors of India which have signed this MOU are Pakistan and Nepal. Now another important is the Dorong Lake in Nagaland. This is a unique lake in itself because it has the largest Amur falcon population in the world. It is also known as the world's Amur falcon capital. So this is the Amur falcon bird, and in 1 minute, in just 30 minutes, you can see more than 1 million of Amur falcons in that specific area. So I can say it's a kind of endemic species to that area. Now, among the falcons are considered under the least concern category of the IUCN classification. However, this Amur falcon is one of the birds that is being threatened in the recent areas. It is seen near to the Pangati village in Doyang Lake area, and they basically come for roosting here from Mongolia to South Africa. So they have a kind of flight from Mongolia to South Africa, and this has now been developed as a ecotourism hotspot. The next is the halting of the Tawang hydroelectric power project. Now, again, the important thing to note here is this project was halted because of the black craned bird that is seen here. So, black necked crane that is seen here is at risk because it is considered under the status of vulnerable in India. It's sacred to Buddhists. It's commonly seen in China. It's protected in Bhutan. But in India, it's under the status of vulnerable species. Now, again, the protection has been given under Schedule 1A species. So, these come basically from the Tibetan Plateau and migrate to the Tawang area during the winter time. As a result, to protect this, you have the hydroelectric project in Tawang that has been recently halted by the National Green Tribunal. Another important thing to note here about National Green Tribunal is it does not interfere into the wildlife acts. However, it interferes into the developmental projects which hamper the environment. The other species which are common to Arunachal Pradesh and the region of Tawang are the red panda, snow leopard. Both of these are also seen in the parts of Sikkim and northern West Bengal. Another important species here is Arunachal macaw. It's a modification, it's a species of monkey. The next is the Biodiversity Act 2002. It aims to promote the sustainable use of biodiversity. The benefits include the setting up of biological resources with equal share to which are given the benefits which are percolated to the nation and the state. It sets up under three states. The first is the national level authority, then you have the state levels, and finally you have the management committees which look into the local traditions and the local loopholes. The next is the South Asian Wildlife Enforcement Network. Now this network, which is also known as Sevan Network, comprises of 8 countries of South Asia, which are these. Now all these 8 countries help to control the transborder wildlife crime that occurs. India has one of the leading roles in the Sevan, and it aims to protect the illegal traffic of wildlife crimes that occur. The next is the blast water discharge. Now this is an important concept to understand. What happens during the loading and the deloading of a ship, you have to maintain the balance, and to maintain the balance you have the blast that is being discharged. So you in the first image you can see loading of the blast water at the source, then you have the blast tank that is full during the voyage, finally you have the discharge of the water at the destination, and finally you have the tank that is being emptied. So what is happening during the coastline where the ships are getting emptied and they are being loaded, at that time you have the blast water discharge that occurs into the ocean. Now if let's say a ship is moving from America to India, it's loaded at America and emptied at India. So when it's loaded, you have numerous species that go into during the process of blast water, and finally when it's loaded at India, these species come out with the blast discharge. So there are kind of invasive species that are attacking or that are moving from one place to another. In India, there are 10 invasive exotic species that are found at the coastal areas of Kerala, which are really harmful to the marine species that are already present. And here are 10 of the most common species that are found with the blast discharge, and they are highly dangerous to the coastal ecosystem of the region. The next is the snowflake corals. Now for the first time these species were recorded or observed in 1972. They are native to the Western Atlantic and the Caribbean areas. However, they are also seen in the areas of the Southeast Asia, that's the Thailand, Indonesia and Philippines. They are sharp and kind of piercing when it comes to it, so they can attach or attack to the metal and even the plastic substances. In India, they are commonly seen in Andaman Nicobar, Gulf of Mannar, Gulf of Kutch and Goa. Now, they are again a threat to ecosystem because the other ecosystem cannot crowd near it. Because of the piercing nature, it destroys the nearby other species that come into the region. The next is the Asia Ministerial Conference on Tiger Conservation. This was recently held in India. Now, the tiger population, if we look onto the global total, you have nearly 3,890 tigers that are present, of which India accounts for the highest percentage, that's highest amount, that's nearly more than 2000 tigers. Again, it's interesting to note India is the only country which has both tiger and lion population simultaneously. There are 13 tiger range countries which are mentioned here. Most of these countries are part of South and Southeast Asia. The Project Tiger was started in 1972 with the aim of conserving nearly 70% of the global tiger population, which is home in, which lies in India. So this conference was held recently in India, in Delhi. The next is the Gorewada Zoo and the Wildlife Rescue Center. This is the India's biggest wildlife rescue center that has been developed near Gorewada in Nagpur in Maharashtra. It is managed by the Forest Department of Maharashtra and it is similar to the Gir National Park that has been established. It is established over a huge area of 1,914 hectare land area. Now the next is another important species is Russian poplars. Now Jammu and Kashmir is known for its poplar trees. However, in recent years there has been a kind of invasion on the poplars with the Russian poplars. Now this Russian poplars is the name per se, however it has nothing to do with Russia. The name comes from Russifrasa, which is a variety or a variant from United States. So this Russian poplars are not from Russia, they are from basically from United States. They grow very fast as compared to the local poplars. They affect the economy because the female poplars here, they create the deltoids and they shed cotton-like material which harms the respiratory tract and creates allergy in common man. However, these poplars are used for creating fruit boxes and they kind of create a canopy on the highway. But the invasion of Russian poplars have severely affected the domestic poplars in the region. So this is again important. The next is we'll come on to the next topic, that is waste management. We have already covered the basic topics on biodiversity. Under waste management, the first thing we'll try to understand is the proportion of waste that India generates. So if you look onto the figures, you have four basic criteria: the electronic waste, plastic waste, medical waste and municipal waste. You have the highest waste in terms of municipal waste, which can be recycled and reused. The medical waste, plastic waste and e-waste should be treated and like disposed in a proper manner. So we'll work around those. Now all the management rules, they were previously management and handling and they have now become the management rules. The same goes for toxic waste, the same goes for plastic waste and e-waste. So in 2011 you had the e-waste management and handling rule, which in 2016 changed to simply the management rules. Now under 2016 some of the important ideas were inclusion of the compact fluorescent lamps, that is the CFL, and the mercury lamps under the e-waste category. Then you have the extended producer responsibility, that was again important aspect that was introduced in 2016, where the producer is responsible for the disposal or the collection of e-waste. And finally, providing penalty for rules violation, proper disposal and recycling. And there would be a single authorization which would be done by the Central Pollution Control Board of India. The next is the Hazardous Waste Management, Handling and Transboundary Movement Rule 2016. The most important thing is other waste category has been introduced in 2016. The previous hazardous acts were in 1989, 2000, 2003 and 2008. On an average, our country generates 7.46 million metric tons of hazardous waste, which comes from 44,000 industries. Now, the basic idea here is to establish a preferential mechanism for disposal. So, the most harmful, the least harmful, and so on. So, you have a kind of preferential mechanism that has been established. The process has been streamlined. There is a kind of single rule or a single window for merger of all approvals. Again, you have a kind of standard operating procedure that has been given for the hazardous waste management. The next is the biomedical waste management. This again changed from 2011 handling to handling and management to 2016 simply management. There was few basic changes. There were few basic changes. The first was shift from 10 categories to 4 categories. There was a kind of barcode system of disposal that has been introduced. The chlorinated plastic bags, gloves and blood bags should be eliminated or phased out within 2 years. And it's important to immunize all the healthcare workers and those involved in handling of biomedical waste, specifically for hepatitis and tetanus. Now, these are the four categories of biomedical waste: yellow, orange, white and blue. Blue talks about broken glassware and metallic implants. White talks about blades, needles and syringes. Orange focuses on the contaminated waste and yellow focuses on the anatomical waste. Now, under laboratory waste, you have three basic categories: the infectious waste, the chemical waste and the non-hazardous waste. So, the disposal mechanism for all the three is different. So, the non-hazardous is the least given priority. The infectious waste should be disposed of properly, and it's highly important to note the disposal of infectious waste. Now, we'll focus on the next topic, that is disaster mitigation. The first is the National Disaster Management Plan, which was laid down in 2016. It has four priority themes which were given under the Sendai framework. Sendai framework, we'll see in the next slide, talks about the 2030 goals. The four priority themes here was understanding the disaster risk, the governance, the reduction in the disaster and the preparedness and early warning for the disaster. So, this was the basic idea. Now, under Sendai framework, as we said, the targets were 2013 for a kind of 15-year non-binding agreement to work for disaster reduction. The basic idea was to work around the economic loss, provide early warning system, to work around the critical infrastructure and the damage caused to the critical infrastructure, the mortality because of the disaster and the international cooperation for the same. So, with this we cover some of the major topics for environment. We'll be covering one more lesson where we'll be talking more about the important and the expected questions for environment. Have a good day ahead.